You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Siame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Wednesday, the 18th of November, 2020, 33rd week in ordinary time. And today we celebrate the dedication of the basilicas of Saints Peter and Paul, apostles. With this dedication, we conclude the celebrations that surround the four major basilicas of Rome. On the 5th of August, we had the dedication of the Basilica of Mary Major, which is right in the center of Rome, near the main train station. Then we had, on the 9th of November, last week, the dedication of the Lateran Basilica, the Cathedral of the Pope, that is not very far from Mary Major. It's a walking distance. I do walk from there to the other one. The ones which are far apart from each other are the ones we are celebrating today. The Basilicas of Saints Peter and Paul. Now, these two basilicas were built on the tombs of the two great apostles who witnessed to the Christian faith in Rome by the shedding of their blood. And why do we have to remember the basilicas? Why do we have to remember the buildings? It is because of the significance attached to them. Especially Saints Peter and Paul. It is very moving for you to enter a church and know that here Paul was buried, here Peter was buried. The major figures in the development of our Christian faith. Whenever I go to the Basilica of St. Paul, I go to seek for wisdom from God through the intercessions of St. Paul, who dedicated his life to spreading the word of God. And I feel that presence of God very close to me. Twice or thrice I've had a chance of going to the Basilica of St. Peter, which is right at the Vatican. And it is thrilling to see the tombs of the popes in that basilica. Those who have succeeded Peter, their tombs are there. And the church is built and the church is built on the tomb of Saint Peter. The blood that was shed by this man who was told by Jesus Christ, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church," stands to this day. Despite the many things that the church has gone through, we see the solid foundation on which the church has been built. Not only in the building, in the structures, but in the doctrine, the firm doctrine that never changes. And I am glad that finally Vatican has released the official statement regarding the controversial issue of our dearest homosexuals, to say the church has not and will not allow any union of those who go against nature. That's it. And it is clear, and it will remain clear. For those of you who were happy that, oh, now the church has become evil, sorry, it will not, and it will never. Let us pray. Defend your church, O Lord, by the protection of the holy apostles, that as she received from them the beginnings of her knowledge of things divine, so through them she may receive even to the end of the world an increase in heavenly grace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading will be taken by Faith Consulate Kamoyo, a Daily Bread member from Arua, Uganda.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 28, verses 11 to 16 and 30 to 31. 3 months later, we set sail on a ship that had wintered at the island. It was an Alexandrian ship with the Dioscuri as its figurehead. We put in at Syracuse and stayed there 3 days. And from there we sailed round the coast and arrived at Rhegium. After a day, a south wind came up and in 2 days we reached Puteoli. There we found some brothers and were urged to stay with them for 7 days. And thus we came to Rome. The brothers from there heard about us and came as far as the Forum of Appius and 3 taverns to meet us. On seeing them, Paul gave thanks to God and took courage. When he entered Rome, Paul was allowed to leave by himself with the soldier who was guarding him. He remained for 2 full years in his lodgings. He received all who came to him, and with complete assurance and without hindrance, he proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ. Brethren, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel passage will be taken by Father Peter Pambana, a Daily Bread member from the Archdiocese of Blantyre, Malawi.
Bid me to come to you on the water. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Matthew chapter 14, verses 22-33. After the crowd was satisfied, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was many furlongs distant from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately he spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Have no fear." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, bid me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of a boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Happy Feast of the Dedications of the Basilicas of Saints Peter and Paul. And many of you may be surprised, why are we taking the readings that are different from what you might be having? We have taken the readings from this special day, this special feast, because we want to focus on the evangelization that took place through these apostles. We are not just focusing on the churches, we are focusing on the personalities that are attached to these churches. Peter and Paul. Beginning with Paul in the first reading of today, we see how he came here, how he came to Rome, and how the Acts of the Apostles concludes with Paul. It is the Acts of the Apostles, but when you go through the Acts of the Apostles, you won't hear much about the other apostles. What you will hear about will be Peter and Paul, the main figures. Others are just mentioned by passing, but those who are said to have done something are mostly Peter and Paul, John. Peter and John going in the temple to pray, and a few others mentioned there, James, the brother of our Lord. But nothing much has been said about what they really did. Paul carries the pages. Paul seems to be the main actor in the Acts of the Apostles, and the conclusion of the Acts of the Apostles is about Paul coming here to Rome. We don't know anything much about his execution from the Acts of the Apostles, because by the time the writer was finishing, Paul was still alive. And the writer, Luke, writes to Theophilus, knowing Theophilus to have been a great influential man. He was a man of excellence. He was influential to an extent of giving the possibility of release to Paul. So that is why he wrote this book of the Acts of the Apostles, expecting Theophilus to go and speak on behalf of Paul, that Paul may be released to continue serving in the mission that was entrusted to him. We don't know what happened after that. But what we know is that during the persecutions of Nero, Paul was executed. And what is impressive about his imprisonment is that while he was in prison, he preached unhindered. He preached while in prison the word of God. Isn't this admirable about Paul? We are imprisoned by many things in our lives. We are going through very trying moments in our lives. This is a kind of imprisonment, but this cannot hinder us from proclaiming the word of God. Paul must be our example. You have trouble in your marriage, and people wonder how you go to church and participate and take up responsibilities at your church despite your imprisonment in that marriage. You are still participating. You are becoming another Paul. You are imprisoned in your sickness. You are going through what people term as terminal illness. And you are there telling people about what Jesus is doing in your life. Despite your sickness, you are another Paul. You have trouble at your workplace. You are imprisoned to your own boss, and you are there telling people about the love of God. You are there showing your faithfulness, your truthfulness, your honesty in the way you conduct your affairs at work. You are another Paul, unchained in your proclamation of the word. This is what we are supposed to be. This is what we are expected to be in our lives as we continue showing to people that Jesus and God is still alive. God is still alive in our lives, and he will continue influencing our lives as we keep proclaiming him freely in our imprisonment. So many things. There are people who say, I cannot even pray because of the things that are surrounding me. I feel imprisoned by this and that. But let that imprisonment be a source of your proclamation of Christ in your life. Pray even more because you are going through such. God wants us to show in our own lives how firm we can be, how trouble which the devil expects to bring us down, to put us down, cannot be a hindrance to proclaiming Christ. We have to be other poles in our lives. Let nothing, let no crisis, the economic depression which has imprisoned us now because of COVID-19 should not be the source of our inactivity when it comes to proclaiming Christ. In fact, this should be the reason why Christ should be known all over the world. We're going to use this moment to proclaim him. We're not going to make any political hindrance. We're not going to make any political imprisonment, any economic imprisonment, any social imprisonment to hinder our proclamation of Christ in our lives. We must preach by word and deed to the world out there. Let them know our God is not dead, he's alive. Paul preached while in prison. Why can't we in our various imprisonments? We're going to preach. That is the Paul we know, and that is the Paul who encourages us today. And when we think of that Basilica of St. Paul, we are reminded of the proclamation we are supposed to make in our imprisonment. The Peter we are presented with today in the gospel passage is the fearful Peter in his boldness. This man is so real. When I look at Peter, I feel encouraged. He was so real. He was so bold and yet fearful. The situation that we find ourselves in. We may look so bored. We may look so energetic. But when trouble comes, we start sinking. But one thing that we learn from Peter is that in that sinking, he cried out to the Lord. He didn't depend. He did not rely on his own power. No, he cried out to the Lord, "Save me, for I am sinking." But he said, "If it is you, Lord, bid me that I come to where you are." Peter knew that what was making him bold was the fact that God is there, the one who has walked on water. So he's bold not because of his own strength, not because of him. "If it is you, bid me come to you on the water." If it is you, I know you, Lord. I know who you are. I am troubled here. I'm going through troubled waters. We have COVID-19. We have many things affecting us. But if it is you, Lord, bid me pass through this COVID-19 without drowning, because I know who you are. I know who you are. If it is you, Lord, I know I'm going to make it. If it is you, Lord, I know this trouble will pass. If it is you, Lord, I know we are going to make it. We will step over this COVID-19 and we will cross over. And we shall come and tell the story how we survived this dangerous pandemic. And we will say it is because we knew who was there. Is the one who has walked on water. Peter's faith is daring faith. And we must have that daring faith where we dare and say, "Lord, if it is you, let me pass through this trouble. If it is you, I will hold on and make sure I pass through the troubled waters of my marriage. If it is you, I will hold on and make sure I pass through the troubled waters of my health. If it is you, Lord, I will make sure I pass through the troubled waters of my finances, my relationships. It is you. And I trust you. And I know you are going to make me an overcomer. I may sink. I may try to sink. But it will not be a reason for me to give up. No. Even when the water is on my neck, I will cry to you. And I know you will rescue me. I trust you. I know the power that you have. If it is you, I will come that side. If it is you, I'm an overcomer and I'm ready to be bold enough to face the challenges of life. That is what Peter wants to tell us today. Are you ready? We give glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Wednesday to you.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is easy.